With that, let's pray. Can we do that? I need God. I need God's grace. I need God's grace around in this area, you know, right in here. But you need God's grace too. You need God's grace in this area. A little bit right here too. Amen. So let's go before God and let's pray and let's get into his word today. Can we? Can we? Father, we thank you for today. Lord, we're just so grateful for the opportunity that we have to be in the house of God. Lord, we don't come into this place for tradition. We don't come to hear from a man, from a woman, from the older, from the young, from the black, the white, the brown, or anything like that. God, we come into this place to hear from you. And we acknowledge that at the Rock, it's Jesus that's our senior pastor. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher, would counsel us and lead us and guide us and direct us and motivate us. Show us and remind us out of your word what your will is for our lives, God, that we might take what you have for us today, walk out of this auditorium and be your church for the world to see. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've blessed us with. Lord, we don't ask these blessings just upon ourselves, but upon all of the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, that you have strategically placed us here in this valley with our brothers and sisters of the various denominations and various churches today hearing and celebrating the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father, we ask that you bless them, bless the Calvary chapels in the area, churches like Harvest and churches like Sandals. And Lord, we thank you for the Grove and Water of Life, Abundant Living. Lord, we thank you for the Way. God, we ask that you bless Ecclesia, Emmanuel Baptist, New Creation, Oak Valley. Lord, we thank you for all the different churches belonging to various denominations, that you would bless them. And Holy Spirit, we ask that you would speak to them as you speak to us today. And we thank you. We give you the praise and the glory and the honor. Holy Spirit, speak to each and every person that's in this place. Lord, now help me for my voice to continue and hold out for the rest of the service today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. I've got my tea, so I'll drink some of that. As I do, go in your Bibles to John chapter 8. And go in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 5. Now put a ribbon in Matthew chapter 5. We're going to look at John chapter 8 today. I'm going to talk to you about the subject of the gift that keeps on giving. And I'm not talking about the fruitcake you got from somebody else. The gift that keeps on giving. When you look at this week is the intermediary week. Last week was Christmas. Yesterday, 2 days ago, we were celebrating Christmas Eve. Now, after Christmas is over, everybody's eyes are set towards the future. Looking towards 2016. Starting to think about what am I going to do in 2016? What am I going to make a difference in? What am I going to change in my life? What are the things that I'm going to start doing that I've never done before? We look back at what we've done in 2015. If you're on social media, big thing right now, you see Facebook is talking about, you know, all of your pictures for 2015 in your life and the year, and the most impacted or the most, you know, whatever commented on or liked photo was. And it's a time of looking at ourselves, of introspection, of looking at ourselves, as well as looking to the future. And we do that in this season. We begin to think about resolutions. You know, the next coming year, as we celebrate New Year next week, we start making New Year's resolutions. You know what I'm talking about? Those promises, those guarantees, those goals, those desires. We make these resolutions. Why? Because ultimately, we want to be a part of something. We want to have fulfillment. We want to have a reason or a cause in our lives. And so we do these things like, you know, we say, oh, you know what? This is the year I'm going to make everything else different. This is the year, 2016. It's the year I'm going to join the gym. And you will for about a week. This is the year I'm going to lose those 20 pounds I've been waiting on. And I'm going to go on that diet. And you probably will, but it's the cookie diet. And we do that. We make our resolutions. I remember one year I made a resolution that I wasn't going to make any more resolutions. And I guess in that, I broke my resolution, so I held to it. So just make a resolution. They're good. They're good. And the reason that they're good is because they cause us to think. They cause us to examine. What do I want to do with my life? Why am I here? I want to be a better father. I want to be a better husband or a better, you know, if you're a wife, I want to be a better wife. Or I want to do better at my job. I want to work harder at getting that promotion or just be a better person this year. I want to be the person that everybody else wants to be around instead of being the negative person all the time. Whatever it might be, we make these resolutions and they're good because they cause us to examine ourselves, to look at ourselves, and to realize that we want to be a part of something bigger than just us. We want to have a reason for life. We want to exist. We want to have a meaningful life, and there's nothing wrong with that. We all should have that. As a matter of fact, it's even written into our Constitution, the pursuit of happiness for each and every person in America. Today, I want to talk about the gift that keeps on giving. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the glory days and what Christmas and the season means about Jesus and his birth, Emmanuel, God with us, and the glory days. If you remember, if you weren't here, it's okay. You can go online you can watch that video or you can listen to that sermon on a podcast or you can go get a CD afterwards. I'd encourage you to grab a hold of it. It's a cool message. We talked about the glory days, and the glory days, we realize they're not the days that we look back to, the days of old, the golden era. No, the glory days are today. We are living in the glory days because of Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. And remember the statement, and I want to really kind of build today off of that statement. The statement was, to those who look, God's glory, his goodness shines in a world of chaos. Today I want to look at that gift that keeps on giving and understand that and picking up where we left off last week in Hebrews, the first chapter. Now, I didn't have you turn there because I'll just paraphrase it on the overhead. Hebrews, the first chapter, verse number 3, tells us that Jesus is the brightness of God's glory, the express image of his person. Jesus is God incarnate. Jesus is the brightness of God's glory. Now, we're talking about glory that shines to those who look. If you think of it like this, in the terms of a lamp, Jesus is the light bulb in the lamp that illuminates God's glory. He is the express image of God's person. So we see that Jesus shines, his glory shines. We live in a time when God's glory is revealed, his goodness is revealed to humanity through Jesus Christ and through his finished work on the cross. Now we realize and we recognize that we are in the glory days. And Jesus, as we think about that statement, the brightness of his glory, Jesus recognized this about himself. He understood his position. Now I had you turn to John the 8th chapter. Look at me at John the 8th chapter, verse number 12. John chapter 8, verse number 12. Jesus says these words. He says, I am the light of the world. You see, Jesus is the brightness of God's glory. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the image of God's person. Jesus is the light bulb, the filament, the luminary in the lamp of the world. Jesus recognized that, and he says, this is God's promise to you, God's promise to me as his disciples, as followers of Jesus. Look at his words to you. He says, I am the light of the world. You, he who follows me, shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Think about it for a moment. What does darkness represent? Darkness represents uncertainty. Insecurity. Darkness brings all sorts of different thoughts and different emotions and different fears and different feelings that we didn't recognize or realize that we were even experiencing. Have you ever been in a dark room in the middle of the night trying to go to the bathroom or make a sandwich or whatever it is? Have you ever gone through your house when it's completely dark and you wonder to yourself, did I pick up the floor? Did I take that shirt off the floor or whatever it might be? I remember one time I was in the forest. We were hiking and we got lost. And I was there in the middle of the night with a couple of other people. I've told the story before. And we were there under the covers of the trees. You couldn't see the sky. And it was pitch black. All we had between three guys was a keychain flashlight. And in the darkness, everything else begins to change. Every sound. Every time the wind blows, every feeling, you are so much more in tune to your insecurities and your insufficiencies in the darkness than you are in the light. I remember we're walking and a twig behind us snaps and everybody's like, what is that? Bigfoot. He's alive. You see, darkness represents fear, insecurity and chaos and inconsistency. The unknown, I can't see what's ahead of me. I don't know what's around me. I'm all alone. And Jesus' guarantee, his promise to you, his promise to me, is that when you follow him, you will not walk in darkness. But you will have the light of life. The light of life, illumination. Jesus, the brightness of God's glory, will shine upon us and we will see fulfillment and clarity and understanding that our lives are a part of something bigger than us. You see, the gift that keeps on giving is Jesus. He's the gift that keeps on giving. Why? Because his light is not like a flash on a camera in here for a moment. All of a sudden, it illuminates everything in the room, but by the time your eyes process it, it's already dark again. No, his light, once it was here, is here to stay. Jesus says, you will not walk in darkness. The gift that keeps on giving. The gift that keeps on giving. But speaking of gifts, a couple of weeks ago, Jesus was talking about gifts. Jesus was talking about giving away. And I'll put it up on the overheads for you just as a review. John 17 chapter. This is Jesus' prayer for you, for me. This is Jesus praying over us, his people, today. And Jesus is talking about us and he says, God, the glory you, God, gave me, Jesus. I love this. He says, I have given them. Who's them? You. You're them. Jesus is talking about you and he says, God, your manifested goodness, God, and the very fact that I am the brightness of your glory, I am the light bulb in the lamp of the glory of God. God, you gave this to me, now I give it to them, you and me. We have it in us. That they, who? You and I, might be one just as we are one. He says, and they and me and I and them, they may be made perfect. That the world may know. There it is. That the world may know. You see, this world, our world, your family, your workplace, your friends, the people that you come into contact with every day, the people that are standing next to you at the shopping market, the people on the other side of this earth are living in a perpetual state of darkness, of insecurity, of chaos, of uncertainty. I don't know what the future holds. And Jesus says, I have come. The glory that God you have given to me, I give to them that the world may know. The world is looking for light. The world is looking for an answer. The world is looking for a savior. If there's any indication of that, look at our entertainment. Every movie that comes out is about a society that is destroyed, a society that is in shambles, and there's some young or unknown or unthought of savior rising up from the ashes to deliver the people from the corrupt or the horrific government or leader or dictator, what it is, the Hunger Games, the Maze Runner, James Bond, I don't know, they're all the same. You see, because our society, our world is crying out. We're in darkness, and we're looking for light, and we're writing the stories, and we're making the plays, and we're writing the books, and we're making the statement that we need something to change. And Jesus says, the glory, the goodness, God, that you gave to me, I give to them so the world would know. Now, how'd you turn to Matthew chapter 5? Go with there. Go there to me. Go there with me. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, verse number 14. Jesus knew this about you and me. As he's speaking to his people, as he's speaking to the listeners on his Sermon on the Mount, on his famous sermon, Matthew, the 5th chapter, Jesus says in verse number 14, he says, you, who's you? You. He says, you are the light of the world. Wait a minute, Pastor Luke, I'm fairly certain about 5 minutes ago, we were in John chapter 8, when Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Yeah, we were there. Jesus is the light of the world, but now Jesus says, listen, I have an understanding that you don't have yet. We see it in hindsight, 2020. Jesus says, church, followers, disciples, I'm the light of the world. If you follow me, you will live in the light of life. But the light is not a light that will shine on you. The light is a light that will shine through you. You are the light of the world. Everybody who has Jesus is the light of the world. Let me drink my tea. Amen. That didn't mix. You're the light of the world. You're the light of the world. You see, the world is looking for an answer. The world is in darkness. The world is in confusion and inconsistency and uncertainty. The world is crying out for solutions. And Jesus says all along, you're the answer. You're the answer. Not because you're smart. Not because you're going to invent the next greatest cure, the next greatest invention. Jesus says, you are the answer because you have me. And I am the light bulb that goes in the lamp of your body. Think about it. You're a lamp. And Jesus says, when you have me, you got that. They don't even sell them anymore in California. You got that 100-watt light bulb. Not that little 27 water that you can buy now. He says, no. I am the light. And he even says this about you and me. He says, listen, you don't take a lamp, light it, and put a basket under it or over it. Don't hide your light. Don't mask your light. You see, if you have Jesus on the inside of you, you are radiating a light of Christ, the answer to the world. And Jesus says, don't hide your light. In Jesus' day, a lamp. He says, don't take a lamp and put it under a basket. In Jesus' day, a lamp was about 4 inches. It's made out of clay, had a little handle, kind of looked like Aladdin's genie lamp, had a big hole in the middle, and had a little spout on the side. You could pour out of it or whatever, but you would pour olive oil into the lamp, and you would stick a string or a wick in there, and then you would light it. They didn't have lighters. It was a lot of effort to make light. They didn't just get to flip a switch. They would light it. He says, you don't go through all the effort. You don't go through all the cost of going down to the market to buy the wick and buy the lamp and buy the olive oil to light. I don't know what. Right? I don't know. They didn't have matches either. I don't even know. Rub two sticks together. You don't go through all that effort to light your lamp and put a basket over it. Because what good does it do? What good does it do? Just like you and I. We don't turn on the light switch of our house when there's a light bulb out. What good does it do? Turn the switch all you want. Nothing will happen. And Jesus says, you are a lamp. And I am the light bulb inside of that lamp. And he says, I don't want you to hide. I don't want you to back off. Well, you know what? That's your thing. That's my thing. We'll all get together. And I'm not going to force. I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. No, Jesus says, shine. Because there's a lot of people out there that are in darkness. There's a lot of people out there that are going to die not knowing the light. And Jesus says, as church, as his believers, we can't afford to back off. He says, shine your light. Because you are the light of the world because of Jesus. But Pastor Luke, they don't want to hear what I have to say. When I talk my Jesus talk, man, they get all mad at me. They say all sorts of crazy things about me. They rag on me on social media. This world has become increasingly anti-Jesus talk. They don't want to hear about your Jesus anymore. That's all right. You know, because Jesus in his time, they didn't want to hear about Jesus then either. They nailed him to a cross. And Jesus said these words in verse number 16. He says that they will see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Jesus says, look, man, you can be all talk you want. The world is watching you. And when they see you lighting the path, lighting around, they will see and they will recognize and they will realize there is something about you that is not you. Because he says they'll glorify their Father in heaven. Wait a minute. You would think the logical conclusion is they would see your good works and pat you on the back. Good job. Have you ever been around a glory hog? Somebody that just is like too good for their own self? When I go fishing, I'm around a bunch of glory hogs. Like, man, I caught a fish. It was like this big. And they're like, yeah, I caught a fish. It was like this big. Whatever, man. Out on the basketball court or out at the job or whatever. Well, I made this many sales today. Psh, I'm salesman of the month. This. What do you got to say? Well, man, whatever. Forget it. I didn't even tell you anything anymore. When somebody's around and they take all the credit and they're a glory hog, what happens? You don't want to be around them. That's right. Why? Because if I say something, you're just going to one-up me, do a better job. Well. No. Jesus says they will see your good works and you won't hog the glory. They will see your good works and they will give God the glory. Why? Here's why. Because the world is in darkness. But the world is shining a light aside from Jesus. mean, think about it. There's a lot of things going on in this world. Things like hunger and things like AIDS and things like, Ebola when that was going on. There's things like human trafficking and all sorts of different things. And the world is shining a light. There are people, good people out there in the world that are saying, you know what? I'm going to make a stand. I'm going to give my money to this. And I'm going to give my life to that. And I'm going to shine my light in a darkness. And it shines. It's visible. It can be seen. It is a light that shines, but it's a small light. But you see, we can shine the light of humanity. We can shine the light of philanthropy, or we can shine the light of Jesus Christ. And the world's light is small, but God's light is pretty big. And it'll light up the room. It'll light up the world. It'll light up the people around you, and people will begin to look at you, and they'll begin to see something about you, and they'll say, hey, wait a minute, I'm shining a light, but your light outshines my light. I don't even see my light anymore. You can turn the lights back on. Why? Because the light that is in you is not backed by philanthropy or philosophy or goodwill to humanity. The light that is in you is so much bigger than any human concept can come up with. And therefore, when people see your life, they will look at your light and they will say, oh my goodness, there is something so bright, so massive, so big about you that my light is this little dinky thing, and I look at that and I'm a little jealous. How do I get that light? Because it's God's light. It's God's light. Because Jesus is the brightness of God's glory. And Jesus gave that glory to us. And Jesus was the light of the world. You were a lamp. You were without a light bulb, or you had a little 15 water. Somebody came up with a 1500 watt light bulb. Jesus Christ. Now all of a sudden when people see the good deeds and they see the light shining, they'll look at that and say, that cannot possibly be you. What is it? What is it? Well, Pastor Luke, I don't got nothing to offer. My life's a wreck. I'm emotionally unstable. I'm super insecure. I don't know where my future holds. I feel like I'm walking around in a little bit of darkness. How can you possibly encourage me or tell me to shine my light? You got nothing to offer. Nope. None of us have anything to offer. I'll tell you from my own perspective. When I preach good, I get a lot of accolades. It's great. When I don't preach good, I don't get none. But people tell me, man, your message about this, it just spoke to me. Your message over here, it changed my life. My family members came in, they got saved because you were speaking, or I got healed when you were preaching because I just, all of a sudden something happened, and it's just like amazing. And all the time, all I ever say when somebody says that, I just say, I'm so glad that I get to be a part of what God is doing. Because you see, I'm a kid who can't apply himself. Barely made it through school. Did just enough to make it through school. I'm the kind of guy that gets to 80% of the things that I like to do and then I quit. I can't even keep a straight thought for more than 30 seconds. But despise all the fact that I've got nothing to offer, I have a light, and the light is Jesus, and the light shines through me. So you may not have anything to offer. You may feel worthless in life, a loser, a downcast, but Jesus took 12 downcast losers and used them to shine a light and change the entire planet for his word, which means the light is not about what you can offer by yourself. That's this light. And some people got a mini mag light. Some people got a full-size mag light. But with Jesus, you got a spotlight. You have the light of the world. Thus, you are the light of the world. See the gift that keeps on giving? It's you. It's you. Because you have Jesus. And Jesus is the gift that keeps on giving. So you have the light, and now you shine, and people see you, and they see Jesus. You are the gift that keeps on giving. So what do I do with my life? What do I do with this? I don't even understand. I've got to go home and process this. I don't even know what to do. It's easy. You're thinking about it. This week is perfect because you're already thinking about your future. You're already thinking about your New Year's resolution. You're already thinking about, what did I do this year? What do I want to do next year? It's so simple. Now take some time to seek after God and His direction for where to shine your light. Because you can be strategic. You can shine your light in a strategic area. You could say, you know what? This year I'm going to shine in my family. This year I'm going to shine with my friends. This year, I'm going to be the person that shines in my workplace and stop complaining about it, and I'm going to start shining about it. I'll start shining with the people that are around me. God, when I go to the grocery store, I want to shine. That's one of my things, man. I go to the grocery store, and I'm like a hermit. Like, don't talk to me. People are like, Pastor Luke. I'm like, I'm an introvert. Sorry. Lord, help me to shine. How can you shine in 2016? Because you can live life on purpose. You can have a strategic plan. God, I'm going to shine with this place. I'm going to shine with that. I'm going to shine with my friends. I'm going to shine with my family. I'm going to even shine with my frenemies. You can shine. Be strategic about it. Because the world is watching. The world is watching. If you've ever said to anybody that you got Jesus, they start watching. Chances are they're watching and waiting for you to fail. But Jesus says, if you've got me, you don't walk in darkness. You walk in the light of life. Paul the Apostle talks about the same subject in Philippians, the second chapter. Philippians, Paul says, do all things without complaining and disputing. You said you had Jesus and then you turned your light bulb off. Do all things without complaining and disputing. Why? That you may become blameless and harmless. Children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Look at this. Among whom you shine as lights. Paul says, the world is watching you. They're waiting for you. They need you. They may not want to hear your words, but they're watching what you do. How can you shine to your world? I've got a really cool video of an illustration of somebody, some people that shone the light of Jesus to a man that was in the NFL. Check it out.
Washington Redskins linebacker Lorenzo Alexander is one of the hardest hitters in the game. Over the last six seasons, he's made a name for himself as a playmaker on special teams. And he gives God all the credit for his success, especially because of the path he took to get to the NFL.
I think before I found Christ, I was really just living for myself and went off to college, you know, wilding out with the drinking, the women, you know, partying. I was kind of the stereotypical, athlete, you know, jock that people, associate us with, you know, how we act off the field.
During that time, he noticed there was something different about some of his teammates. Yeah.
And they didn't really, you know, say, I'm a Christian, you know, you should believe in God. I just saw the way they walked through the room, you know, the way they dealt with their family, the way they dealt with their kids, how they approach work every day. You know, guys like Brandon L., James Thrash, Renardo Wynn. I mean, these guys, I mean, it was just pouring out of them. I mean, you can't miss it. I mean, Randall L., mm-hmm. I mean, he bounces around every day. It could be rain, sleet, snow, or sign. He's walking with, you know, God on his shoulder, in his ear, you know, has that book with him. He just has. My heart was broken. I was missing something. And I saw these brothers. I said, man, I need to get what they get, what they have, whatever that is, I need it.
Lorenzo began meeting with the team chaplain, Brett Fuller, and he had a lot of questions for him.
You know, how I fit in this big picture, you know, where do I fit in the grand theme, scheme of things, and how can I have a better relationship with the Lord?
Lorenzo gave his life to the Lord. And he was surprised by what started happening in his life.
I think when you first come to the Lord, a lot of the big things just kind of fall off, like drinking. Like when I drink, I'm just, you know, all the morality goes out the window as far as, you know, right and wrong and all that. And I mean, that was like one of the first things he chopped off me, bam. So I stopped drinking and really didn't have the thirst for it anymore because I just knew where it takes me. I think my motivation changed, not living for myself anymore, living to please him, his standards, not other people, because I know if I please him, everybody else is going to be more than happy with what I'm doing.
So you see in Lorenzo's life, did you catch what he said? He said that there were some people on his team, and it wasn't that they were saying, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian. Remember the statement he said? He's like, he said, you couldn't miss it. Light. You see, the world is watching, and there are people all around us. People that we know and people that we don't know. And even you yourself in this place, many of you, you feel like Lorenzo was. A little bit lost, a little bit dark, a little bit insecure, a little bit not sure of what's going on. But you see, Jesus is the gift that keeps on giving. He is the light of the world, and his promise to us from John the 8th chapter, verse number 12, is that when you follow me, you will not be in darkness. You will walk in the light of this world. You are the light of the world. So the question is, what are you doing to shine? What are you doing to shine? How can you shine your light? I'll take a little segue for that. And if you're with us, if you're part of the church family, I want to invite you to do what we do. In the month of January, the church leadership here always goes through a fasting period, whether it's the entire month. Some people go for 40 days. Some people just do it for a meal, for a week, or for whatever it might be. The leadership team at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center always fasts in the month of January to seek after God. You can see, what is fasting? Fasting is simply setting aside a meal or food for a certain period of time to get into a deeper experience with God, to know God on a deeper level, to hear answers that I wouldn't normally hear in the chaos and the noise of life, to set those things aside and to say, God, I will quiet myself. God, I will listen to your voice. I want to invite you to join with us in fasting for the month of January. Whether it's breakfast, whether it's a lunch, whether it's one day a week, whether it's the month, whether it's desserts, or whether, you know, it could be anything. You could fast steak. You could fast coffee. Whew, that's a tough one. Whatever it might be, to set aside something for a certain period of time, whether it's a day out of the month, a day out of the week, to say, you know what, I'm going to take this and I'm going to skip this time and I'm going to focus on God. And I'm going to ask God, like that thought was, God, I'm going to seek you for how I can shine my light. God, I want you to speak to me. Give me a purpose for my light. Give me a direction where and whom to shine my light. To seek after God in the month of January, to shine your light for the month or for the year of 2016. Because you see, the world is watching, like Lorenzo. There are people you may not know that are watching, and all it takes is for you to shine. You know, they may not come to you and ask you to get saved. You notice how Lorenzo went to the chaplain and not to the players. But because you shined your light, somebody saw God. You think about it. You can shine a light. You can give somebody a meal across the world. You can pay a dollar a month or a dollar a day to give somebody an education, and for 25 years, I'll have a wonderful education. You'll make a huge difference in that person's life. Or you can shine your light. You can shine your light with the gospel of Jesus Christ, and you can show somebody who was living in utter darkness that there is a God who loves them, a God who knows them, a God who cherishes them, and that there is light for their dark situation, and they will come to know Jesus. And that is not just a lifetime impact. That is an eternal impact. That is a big light. Hosea was talking about a fast in Hosea, the 8th chapter. Hosea kind of had to eat his words a little bit. He's a prophet, and he was telling the king, I'm going on a journey. King says, let me give you my guards. Let me give you some people surrounding me. And Hosea's like, man, I'm with God. I don't need none of that stuff. I got God on my side. And Hosea gets out into the wilderness and out into the forest, and he realizes, wait a minute, there are bandits, there are raiders, and there are people who hate me on this road. So he starts thinking, oh, dang it. Should have done something about that. Hosea says these words. He says that we fasted and we entreated God for this, for protection, for safety. And the Lord answered our prayer. That's what fasting is all about. Taking some time to set aside something, whether it's a meal, whether it's a day, whether it's a week, whether it's 21 days, if you do the Daniel fast out of Daniel the 10th chapter, or you can do the Daniel fast out of Daniel the 2nd chapter, whatever it might be. It's between you and God. It's not about how you look. It's about between you and God, seeking after God. As a matter of fact, Jesus says these words. Jesus says in Matthew the 6th chapter, he says, and when you fast. Dang it. I wish he would have said, and if you fast. He said, and when you fast. I love that. Comb your hair. Wash your face. Brush your teeth. Yep. Says no one will notice that you're fasting. It's not about looking all miserable and pious before God. He says, except your Father, who knows what you do in private. And your Father, who sees everything, the New King James says, everything in private will reward you in open. Just like Hosea, on his face before God. God, I need your protection. Us, the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, on our face before God, saying, God, I need your direction. Because God, I want to shine my light. I want to shine so bright that people see me and they recognize that that's not me. They recognize that that can't possibly be me because that's bigger than me. I want to be part of something bigger than me. Because Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the gift that keeps on giving. And you have Jesus in you, which means you have the light of the world. You are the light of the world. You have Jesus, the brightness of God's glory, his goodness that the world is looking for. And we, his people, have to be a light to the darkness. So I want to encourage you this week, get with God. God, what can I do to shine my light? Who can I shine my light on? God, help me to shine your light in my life. And listen to the words of God and watch what he does in this next year, in the Inland Empire and around the world, in your family, in your job, with your coworkers, with the people that drive you nuts, wherever it might be, shine his light because you are the gift that keeps on giving. You can be drained by people, but you can never be drained by God because he fills you up to where you can never be emptied. That's because you got a big light. Jesus. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. Well, before we leave, I'll let you guys out in just a couple of minutes. You'll even get out a little early today. It's amazing. I have turned a new leaf. If you're just visiting, I'm always late. Before we leave, I want to do one more thing. We're talking about Jesus, the light of the world. And there are those of you in this place today. You may not have that light. When you look down at yourself and you're in this period of introspection and retrospection, looking back and looking inside, saying, you know what? If I examine my heart, if I examine my life, I feel a lot like I'm walking in darkness. I feel a lot like I'm just missing out on something. And I want to encourage you, let's take a look at your life. Now, a lot of people are getting up and leaving. I understand some people got places to go, but if you don't have to, please give me a minute. I'll let you out in just a minute. Take a look at your heart. Take a look at your life. So often what happens is we think, well, because I hope that I'm right with God, that the light is on in my life. But you know what happens is hope doesn't bring it. A positive thought doesn't bring it. Well, but Pastor Luke, as a child growing up, my parents told me that I was a Christian or I was raised Catholic. So I've always been a religious person. Doesn't that mean something? I mean, I always thought that meant that I was going to have the light of God in my life. A title doesn't bring a light. So often what happens, we think, well, I'm a good person, and I do good things. Yeah, we saw that good things shine lights. But you can see that the light only shines a little bit in the darkness of life. There's more to life than just good works and living and dying. The Bible says that eternity is set on the heart of men. We can't comprehend it. We think about it. We want to make a difference. Have you ever been to a good funeral? See, a good funeral is when people look at the impact of somebody's life. Not how much stuff they collected. Not how many places they traveled or how many pictures they had on their wall. It's the impact of a life. See, Jesus says that I have come to impact your life so that you can impact others. have a good life. It's not just about a title. It's not just about a church prayer or you know, a membership. It's not about raising your hand in a church service or anything like that. About religion. It's about Jesus. Today I want to give you the opportunity to examine your heart, to examine your life, and to look at that. So often we think that good works are what make people go to heaven and be right with God. But Jesus says, the Bible tells us that that our good deeds, our little tiny light, are like filthy rags to God's righteousness. We can never add up. Can't work it, didn't deserve it, can't buy it. The only thing you can do is accept God's salvation. And that's Jesus Christ. See, it's not about how you believe or how I believe. I remember one young lady was telling a friend of mine, he says, you know what, I believe that if you be good, do good, it's all good. And that's my belief. She said, that's my belief. As to say, you know what, you do what you want, I'll do what I want, and we'll all figure it out together. But you know what? Jesus said these words. He said that he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one, he said, goes to the Father except through him. Not all roads lead to heaven. As a matter of fact, only Jesus. Only a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. A relationship that changes your life. A relationship that turns the lights on in the darkness of your life. That is the only thing that leads to eternal salvation with God. And right standing with God and a light shining in your life. Jesus was talking to a man by the name of Nicodemus in John the 3rd chapter. Nicodemus was a great person. Nicodemus did all sorts of good things. He gave to the poor. He memorized Bible scriptures at the time. They were the Torah. Nicodemus did all the right things. And Jesus says these words. Instead of patting him on the back, Jesus says these words. You must be born again to see the kingdom of God. You see, because it's not about your outward actions. It's not just about, well, I can look the part and I can play the part. It's about what's on the inside of you that makes a difference. And the only way to get the light of life on the inside of you and inside of me is through Jesus Christ. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one, he says, goes to the Father except through him. And he says these words, you must be born again. What does born again mean? Well, you know, when you think about movies, when you think about society, they think of that crazy, out of control, weirdo Christianity. Can I tell you something? I don't care what Hollywood or internet's defined it as, born again. When you look at it from God's perspective, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. Here it is. Means that you've given all of your heart, you've given all of your life to God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. You see, God didn't send Jesus to die on a cross so that you and I could attend church every once in a while and think we're okay. He didn't send Jesus Christ to die on a cross so that we could wear a crucifix around our neck and think that that's okay because Jesus died for a symbol. No, Jesus died for you, and he died for me. And in return, he wants all of our heart, and wants all of our life. And Jesus says, listen, the thief, you know this. A robber doesn't come to your house except to steal your stuff, to kill and to destroy your life. Jesus says, I have come that you would have life, have it more abundantly. So often we think about, well, it's all about what happens when I die. That's important. It's eternity. Your life is small compared to eternity. But Jesus says, I want you to have life here on earth as well. Some of you in this place, there's an emptiness on the inside of you. You try to fill it with things. Material, possessions, relationships, whatever it might be, titles. But it seems like no matter how much you try, no matter how thirsty you are to fulfill this hole, that no matter what you do, it can never fill up the hole, the emptiness on the inside of you. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole. God says, it's my place. Let me fill that emptiness. Let me illuminate that darkness. Let me shine on your life. Today I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus said these words. He said that if you confess him before men, he'll confess you. He said, if you deny him, he'll deny you before his Father. The decision's yours. God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. And some people say, well, if God wants me, he'll take me. God wanted you so much, he sent Jesus to die for you. And now in return, he wants you to accept him. Like a gift, the Bible says the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Like any gift you've ever received, you got some maybe on Christmas where you gave them away. The person, the recipient of that gift had an opportunity to accept it or to reject it. I bought my wife a pair of shoes. She rejected them. Salvation, it's a gift. It's a gift. And it comes by accepting Jesus Christ into your heart and into your life. They say, Pastor Luke, what does that mean as a man? Well, here's what I'll do. I'll give you the opportunity in just a moment. I'll count to three. I'm going to go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud just like that. And when I do, I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I'm making the decision today to follow Jesus. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I am tired of living in darkness. I am tired of living in uncertainty. And the light that you talked about is the light that I've been looking for. And today, I want it. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. Ah, but Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. No, listen, I'm not here to embarrass you. That's not my job. I'm here to build you, to encourage you, and to equip you. So I'll see your hand, I'll acknowledge you, put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there, following through together with your decision and your commitment. Who should raise their hands if you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus? If that's you in just a moment, when I count to three, pop your hand up. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child, but you're kind of feeling like that darkness. You're kind of feeling that, I just don't know. If that's you in just a moment, listen, don't walk out of this place with I don't know. You need to know, because you need to have that, the light of life on the inside of you. If you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing, if you've been running from God instead of to God, maybe even doing the church thing, you know, you come to church on Christmas and on Easter, and that's okay. Listen, let's make today the day you go forward in your relationship with Jesus Christ. He says to a church in the book of Revelation, I'm coming back, and when I return, I'd rather find that you're hot. He says, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, I'll vomit you, I'll expel you, I'll reject you out of my mouth. It's a shocking statement. And it's his way to say, church, wake up. Stop doing it on your own. Stop shining your little light. Get a hold of mine, because it will change your life. But it starts by making that decision. Today, if that's you, all across this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, side to side, if you're around campus watching by television, or you're even at home on the live stream, man, I'm so glad that you stuck with us today. There's a little button, if you minimize your viewer, a little button that says, no God, you can click on that. But for you guys in this place today, you've had doctors and dentist appointments. Today, it's a divine appointment. You're here in this room right now for this reason, because God's calling you home. So it's time for you to accept life and light through Jesus Christ. So I'm going to count to three, and when I do, if that's you all across this auditorium, even you guys in the family rooms, I'll see you. You pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge you, put it right back down, and we'll follow through. We'll do it together right after that. You guys ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. One, two, three. I see you guys. Don't clap, don't clap. One, two, three, four. See you guys right over there. Four wise people. Five, I see that hand right over there. Anybody else in this place? Ushers are pointing. Got you right there in the middle. Anybody else in this place? I see a hand. Okay, they went down. Ushers are pointing over there. Give me a little wave. Give me a little wave. Oh, look at you guys. Look at you, my man. I see you, buddy. Anybody else in this place today? Say, man, I wonder if I should. I got you, my man. This is your moment. This is your time. Say, man, I'm going to go forward with Jesus today. I'm making that decision. I'm changing my life. I'm accepting. I see you. I see you, my friend. Anybody else in this place? Man, I wonder if I should. I don't know. Should I? Yes, you should. If you wonder, you should. You should. Anybody else today? I'm going to close it down. Anybody else? Well, praise God. I think it was about 8 or 9 wise people. It's awesome. It's great. All right, here's what we're going to do. All of you that raised your hands, maybe you didn't raise your hand. You were kind of thinking about it, but you just didn't know if I could. Listen, it's not too late. You raising your hand says, I'm going to make a decision. You know this. This is logic 101, reasoning 101. Every decision requires action for it to do something in your life. You can decide to do anything and not do anything about it, and it'll never happen. So today, you've made the decision. Now we're going to act on it, and we're going to do that together. We're going to follow through together right here, right now. Today is the day of your salvation. So if you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, it's all right. In just a moment, we're all going to stand. My buddy over here, Elijah, is going to sing a song. If you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Look, if somebody next to you raise their hand, say, come on, shine a light, I'll go with you. Or look to somebody and say, you know what, will you come with me? Get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle, and come meet me right here at this altar. And we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. Let's all stand. If that's you in this place, come on. Come meet me right here. This is your moment. This is your time. Come on, wherever you're at.
Amazing love, how can be?
You're fine, buddy. I got to get a good one. Good one. Yes. Yes.
Amazing love.
If that's you, come on. They're still coming. We'll wait for you. Awesome. Awesome. Praise God. Hey, guys, look it. I want to tell you something. Today, it's a day celebration. It's the first day of the rest of your life. It's your new birthday. You're going to get born again. Give your heart to Jesus Christ. You know what? Maybe you made a lot of bad decisions in your life. Maybe you made some dumb ones. Maybe nobody's ever told you, but let me be the first one to tell you today. Good job. Good job. You're making a great decision. Good job. Great job. Making the best decision you possibly can make to choose life with Jesus Christ. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here waving at you? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really cool guy. He's going to do a couple things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. Look, I'm as weird as it gets. Look at my voice, all right? You made it through me, okay? I'm as weird as it gets. He's going to take you guys right over there. Here's what he's going to do. I'll tell you. He's going to lead you in a prayer. Okay, you're going to ask Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that very much anymore. The leader of your life. You're inviting him into your life. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information. Why? Because we want you to leave this place hooked up. We want to set you in the right direction for the rest of your life. So we've got a little book. It's easy reading, about 30 minutes. We even got one for kids. It's like a comic book. So cool. All right, it'll help point you. Walk out of this place and say, what do I do next? We're going to point you in the right direction. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you back to hang out with a friend. Somebody that will meet with you right here at church to buy you a cup of coffee, get you soda, hang out with you as a family, even in the children's ministry, to teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks, to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for your life. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with Pastor Joel. Hallelujah. Amen.